Welcome back to another episode of the Hawk Vision Podcast. I am your host, Chuck Hawkins, here to help you shorten the learning curve on your way to greatness. Make sure that you like, share, and subscribe across all of your social media platforms, especially here on YouTube. More importantly, guys, share this podcast with other visionaries just like you. We're obviously doing something really, really big here, working to be the premier location to help you bridge the gap to your personal and professional success. And I can't thank you enough for all the DMs, comments, and messages. We absolutely cannot grow this show without you. That being said, guys, listen, it's rare that I get this excited, but our guest this week is not only an extremely successful entrepreneur, but she is helping service providers and business owners master their messaging by leveraging video in a way that helps her clients get noticed, gain visibility, and truly thrive. We go back almost 10 years, and I have to say that while there are very few entrepreneurs that I look to as prototypes, this guest is untouchable. Her client reviews, her resume of success, and commitment to helping others is unmatched. She is not just a video coach. She is not just a content strategist. She's a true visionary, someone that has built a trusted brand that I have so much respect for. And this woman is just amazing. And I cannot be more grateful for her time because, guys, when I tell you she drops gems in her sleep, get ready to have your vision expanded. Miss Tanya Smith, welcome to the show.
Oh my goodness. I need to bring you everywhere I go. Do the intro for me, Chuck.
That is so fun. Listen, for you, easy. I will do that all day long, all day long. It's so good to have you on the show. Thank you for making some time for us.
Oh, thank you for having me. Thank you for the invite.
Look, is that a little thug tear? I'm so excited. Yes. So listen, we could obviously, you know, I have like a billion questions for you. I will start with the proverbial, what got you into entrepreneurship for those that don't know who you are and building your business? What got you in the game?
Gosh, you know what got me into even deciding that I was worthy of being an independent business owner? I was actually in tears because we had just moved to Dallas. I say we, but it was me and my newborn baby had just moved to Dallas. My yes. husband was still in Indiana at the time. And we were struggling because he was like, it was right after 9/11. Ooh. And he was like, hey, if I quit, I don't know if I'm going to be able to get another job. So he was staying up there while I was here. And it seems like that's the story of our life, to be honest with you, Chuck. But, wow. But I was approached by a lady in the mall. And in Dallas, you can imagine, I was approached by a lady in the mall. Right. And she was like, hey, you're so beautiful, your skin. I would love to talk to you about skincare.
Network marketing.
And that, honestly, let me tell you, her message about having the freedom to choose how I worked, yes. where I worked, and what I did, that message resonated so much with me. And even though now, fast forwarding all these years later, even now, that still is the part that resonates with me, that I have my own freedom of creative expression. I can do what I want because it's my business. I can make it whatever I want it to be, whatever I see in my head, I can create that.
Right.
And so I ended up laughing at her at first, but then I took her up on the offer for lunch.
Okay.
And next thing I know, I was learning and growing through the process. So that's how I started, honestly.
I love it. Yeah, I think that I don't care what type of business you run. I think everybody should do network marketing at least once or twice, because you plug into these people that understand personal growth and the trajectory of how hard it's going to be to launch and what happens when your friends and family give up on you or they're exhausted as customers. Like, they really, really talk you through that. And that support system is amazing. So I'm a fan, you know, that's my industry, my baby industry too. So I love it. You talk about simplifying the video creation process. And the more I jump online, whether it's Reels, IG, TikTok, video seems to get harder and harder. How do we simplify the process to help brands grow?
That's a really excellent question, because it does, even for me, it feels like it's getting more and more complex. So what I'm always looking for, and what I would suggest to anybody who's trying to keep it streamlined, is first you have to start with a plan. I think a lot of people jump out there and they're thinking that my video is going to be the next viral thing. And they're focused so much on viral, viral, viral. How can I go viral? Like, that's the common question that I get from people is, how can I do this? And my, you know this about me, my MO has never been, let me do this get rich quick scheme. It's
Right.
always been slow and steady wins the race for me.
Yes.
So when I work with my clients in terms of simplifying any type of content strategy, whether it's video or something else, one of the keys is to helping them to understand that at the core of simplification is that you are multiplying yourself. So when you record that single 45-minute or 30-minute video, you then reformat that, repurpose that into multiple clips that then become pieces of content that continue to work for you. So you recorded that Facebook live stream, like I do every
Yes.
week, 30 minutes. That gets converted into at least 8 different pieces of content. So that becomes a blog, that becomes, 30-second or 15-second clips that are now going to go on Reels or go on TikTok or wherever the heck I'm going to put them on stories. So simplification to me is all about figuring out the strategy that's going to work for you to take your hard work that you've laser focused to create
Yes.
and then making that continue to work long after you're done.
You know, it's funny. I was having a conversation with someone not too long ago, and I was telling them that the video aspect of the business, you know, TikTok, Reels, Instagram, all that good stuff, even on YouTube, is often so hard that we spend so much time there that we forget to answer the emails and the DMs that the videos create, right?
Yeah.
So
Yeah.
how do you help corral that part? You know, you talked about having a plan. What does that look like for somebody that is fortunate enough to be one of your clients?
Right now, I'm actually working with 3 clients in a small group coaching program. And one of the key things that we're really working on first, because I think they thought initially they were going to come in and it's going to be like, hey, we're creating videos, which they are. We're doing baby steps, though.
Right.
And the baby step that helps us to get to the place that you're talking about is figuring out where your audience is. Who is your audience? Because one of the things that I think that leads us into the situation you just mentioned is we think we have to be everywhere.
Yeah.
Like, I haven't made a decision to be on Snapchat or TikTok yet, not officially. Not
Right.
officially.
Right.
That's just not, but I know where my money is.
Let's
I
go.
know where my audience plays and where I'm, and what I'm doing is I'm building up that pipeline first and then moving to the next thing. So what I'm teaching them is that it's important to understand first where are your audience members, your potential leads, and what I call the most valuable video viewer. So we call that the MV3. Some people call it an avatar, some people call it a brand persona. There's all these different titles. For me, it's who are the people that you want to attract into your video viewing audience that are more likely to actually invest in your programs, products, and services?
Nice.
Because a bunch of likes and vanity metrics, likes and oh girl, that was so great, bye.
Yeah,
That's not, that doesn't pay the bills.
I tried to send PG&E a like the other day, and it didn't work out too well. It didn't work.
Right. So just thinking through, where's your audience? Where do you want to be and spend your time? Because if you don't want to be in all the places, then why are you trying to be in all the places?
Yeah, I think that's huge that you mentioned finding out where your actual potential customer can be, because we know, you know, obviously Instagram is king right now, but depending on what your services or what your offerings are as a service provider, your core client could be on Facebook, they could be on LinkedIn, and you spending all this time on Instagram, just, you know, brainwashing yourself that you got to get Instagram going when you could make 6, 7 figures off of Facebook or LinkedIn alone.
That's right. That's right. And look, you can always expand, but
Right.
you need to get something up and running. And instead, what we do is we spread ourselves so thin that we end up burning out and not doing anything.
Yeah, no,
So the
totally
focus,
agree.
that's the important thing.
So I have to admit, Kashira Moffitt's been on the show, amazing business coach, one of my favorite people online, basically made me submit to getting on camera, right? She beat me up about it. And then I told you, I was like, how could I be on YouTube? How could I even have this thing recorded and not have you on? But how do you help people get over the fear of being on camera, especially when we're in a time where if it's not on camera, it basically never happened?
That is at the core of everything I do and everything I talk about is that confidence on camera. And what I would share is that confidence is not a destination. I think that's what people think is they think that once I have this, once I get confidence, everything's gonna be great and I'm gonna be so wonderful on video. Like it's just they think it's something that you like bottle up and you drink it and now all of a sudden, bam, you're confident. But it is a it's
Coffee
a
works like
journey. Coffee does help.
that. Coffee
But
helps. Coffee helps. I'm sorry, go
it's a
ahead.
journey. It's a journey. It's like it's something that you continue to build. And here's the thing, you have to build up competence in order to be more confident. So the more you take action, the more you choose to take a certain action, even in spite of the fear and the butterflies and the anxiety that you may have, and the more you train yourself and the more you learn about the process of doing video, I feel like that helps to build that confidence. But there are other things that I talk to people about as well in terms of some things that sometimes are psychological factors that maybe we didn't even realize were blocking us, right? One of the things, the two things that we talked about first, the first 2 weeks of our coaching program had to do with building that confidence first. Again, people think they can jump right in and just go. But what they discover is that there are some things, there's some limiting beliefs, and there's negative self-talk that we've been telling ourselves.
Yes.
My nose is too big. I have a pimple today. So and so might be on the other side watching me and judging me. All of these things. And guess what? They might be. Right? I've had some trolls for real. I've had some trolls. Because look, you're going to put yourself out there and be vulnerable and on some level when you're doing a live stream especially. But I think that that it starts with you making the decision. You have to make the decision you're going to do, you're going to try it, put your toe in the water and try it, and then the rest will come. The habit of going live and the habit of being on camera will help with the confidence.
That whole answer is a snippet, so feel free to repurpose that. That was just so amazing right there. And it's funny because Charvette Mitchell says you only need 51% confidence, right? And 51% allows you to get started. 49% can be fear, acknowledge it, keep it moving, but that 51% of confidence allows you to get started and keep moving.
I
Absolutely
love
awesome.
Charvette, by the way. Love Charvette.
Listen, her delivery is so pure, right? That you can't help but to fall in love with the style, you know what I mean? The grace that she presents with. She is in her own lane, and I absolutely love it. Absolutely love it. You mentioned one of the cheat codes that we hear all the time, which is setting aside some of that time to create all your video on the same day. But recording and editing are not the same thing. Do you use a particular software? What's your scheduling cheat code for that part? Or do you edit all your videos on the same day, which is a different day from recording? Like, how does that happen?
So that's a really interesting question. And I'll tell you, I'm trying something new very soon. But what I have been doing to work around that, let me tell you my cheat sheet. My cheat code is I go live. And it is what it is. And I haven't been doing a whole heck of a lot of editing. I actually did have to go in and I re-recorded four different videos and edited them all today for a specific purpose because it was part of a process, a plan. But on the weekly, I do my live video and I'm so clear on what my pre-workflow looks like what's my checklist for what I'm going to do to prepare. What do I do when I'm on? And then what do I do with that when I'm off? And because I have those checklists and those sequences and outlines ready to go, I feel pretty confident about the way that my live stream turns out. So I don't do a lot of editing because it is authentic and real as it comes. Like whatever I say that day
Whatever comes out.
is going to be in there. And people are loving and engaging with that because it is so real and it's not produced. It's like not highly produced. However, to your question, from a production standpoint, what my game plan is, I use Wondershare Filmora. Yeah, I use that just because it was an easier learning curve. I've been using that for years for editing. I use Wondershare Filmora. It doesn't have all the perks that, like the Adobe suite has, right? But it was affordable, it was easy to learn, and they've added a lot of features since I first started using that like 5, 6 years ago. So I stick with it because it's easy. And from an editing standpoint, what my game plan is right now is that I will be taking my live streams that I'm just like off the cuff, and I am going to produce them within 48 hours. So my
Nice.
goal is to
Ambitious.
record on Thursday. Yeah, exactly. Be efficient. I gotta be efficient because I also outsource my video to my guy who takes it and converts it into blog form for me. So he has a deadline. And I also want to be able to take that produced version of the live stream to narrow and shrink it down a bit instead of having all the engagement conversation in there. That is then going to be converted into other forms as well, that condensed version with the captions and everything else in it. So,
Nice. Now I'm a fan of anything low. I'm what they call low tech, high check. So when people ask me about softwares, I'm like, listen, go to Google, find the top 10 and play around with all of them and find the one that you can use that does not make it feel like more work. That's mine. But I think that Wondershare, that's actually a really good platform. I haven't used it in a while, but we always get caught up in the new stuff. And no, I think that I love that you stick to what works, right? So that's what's awesome there. So one of the things that I love about your business is that everything is always so intentional. And we've been rocking for what? This is our 10-year anniversary at this point,
10
right?
years.
You've always been so intentional about how everything piggybacks off of each other or recalibrates, repoints you into another direction within the business. And I was doing my research and I saw the Stream Like a Boss Amazon store. Was that birthed out of getting the same questions over and over again, or was it an intentional add-on to the business?
It was both. It was both. It was both because I have always had people, just like you, over the years, I've always had people ask me, what should I buy? What should I invest in next? Right? And I've been through a graveyard full of, if you saw my, there's a space right now where I have stuff where I'm like, do I want to sell it? Do I want to keep it? Because I don't want to be a hoarder, but I'm like, so I have always been asked, and the other thing, because I earned the nickname Walking Google years ago because of the apps that I've always recommended. I think when way back when we first met, I probably was doing Click of the Week somewhere around
I
that
remember
time, and
that.
I was and I was reviewing different apps. So between the apps that I recommend, I have a whole list of apps that I recommend, but I now keep that inside of my video community. To refer them to specific apps that they might need to help them streamline. But then I also have that store, the Amazon store, because I just got this. Okay, I don't believe in coincidences. So something popped up for me about becoming an Amazon influencer. And I was like, I don't have enough anything. Like, I'm not big enough. Why, how could I do that?
The lies you tell on interviews, but keep going.
No, seriously. That this is my thought. This is my thinking. And I thought, well, you know what? I'm just gonna try it anyway. I'm gonna apply, see what happens. Because they review like your presence on social and all that other stuff. And so I ended up getting approved. And then I was like, okay, well now I can easily organize all the different things that I promote. I promote webcams and I promote, microphones and all the things that I have in my little setup store, And so I thought this is a cool way for me to organize because I pretty much, especially with COVID, everything I was doing was on Amazon. Like Amazon showed up multiple times a day.
You see, they
So
just before we started going, you see, they knocked at
they did.
the door.
Yeah, so I was like, hey, how can I use this? But I did not really do what I should have been doing with it, honestly, Chuck, because I still was second guessing myself. Like, I don't know why they approved me, right? But I did start kind of soft promoting it and sharing with people that I had the store. I called it my gear store on the on my website. It's a gear link that goes to the Amazon shop. But recently, this past week, I did my very first Amazon live stream. And I got a taste of that. And people were buying stuff because it was Prime Day. And I was
Oh
like,
my
oh,
God.
this is going to be a new branch.
It's a new
This is
game.
something I'm getting ready to really kind of let me map this out and figure out how this fits into my strategy. So intentionally, I am intentional now about how I'm going to be leveraging it.
Yes.
But it
But
definitely was a godsend. Like I wasn't thinking big enough.
that is so I get, I get excited when me and you talk, but the thing that throws me off about that is because it wasn't what a few months ago I was like, hey, Tanya, real quick, I need a camera. Which one should I get? Right. And you didn't even throw me the link. I mean, you were fortunate enough to actually answer me, but now that makes sense because you were still kind of walking yourself through, like, am I good enough to have this type of platform? You are so awesome. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it.
Look, don't we all second guess where we are? No matter where we are, we keep looking back like, well, maybe I'm still back there. And I think that's just part of being human, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So.
We talked a lot on this show about imposter syndrome and second guessing and building confidence and all the things that entrepreneurs, kind of go through along their progression to whatever level of greatness that they get to. And I think the part that we always forget is that we're still human. None of us are experts. And the experts that we do know always talk about how much time they spend reading and re-educating themselves. And we forget that, especially in our community. We're like, if you're not already killing it, you don't count.
That's
Right.
right.
So yeah, I can we could go forever, forever, just on every topic. Now I remember your origin story, right? I'm obviously big on Marvel and Avengers, but I remember your origin story to entrepreneurship when the lady approached you for network marketing. Those terms, as you think about them now, future, legacy, family, financial freedom, how do they feel now that you are, actually coaching others and an established entrepreneur? How do those terms feel now?
They feel like they're closer. They don't feel like I'm not there yet. Like the legacy, it's a different the way that I was thinking about it back then, 14 or so years ago, I was not clear on what my vision was. I just knew that, hey, it's out there somewhere. So it kind of felt like, that fuzziness. If you just turn on a TV and it's fuzzy and the picture's not quite clear, at least with the old
I was about to
TVs.
say the TVs that we started with.
Back then, back in the day. And then it got clear, right? So now I feel like the lens is starting to clear up and I'm getting more clarity. And now, because honestly, I have a big milestone birthday this year.
35.
Sure. Yeah. No, I'm turning 50.
Are you serious?
I'm turning 50 in September.
You look amazing. I would
Thank you.
never, I would never,
50.
as even as long as we've known each other, I would never guess that you were anywhere close.
Yes.
Wow.
Dude, that's half a century.
And you've been killing it just as long. That's amazing. Happy early
Oh,
birthday.
thank you. Thank you. But here I feel like I'm at this point where it's like, do it or don't do it. You either get it done or you don't. And so I have really found myself, to be honest with you, Chuck, in that mindset. I'm getting more and more into, I'm fitting into my skin more. I'm feeling like, okay, it's go time. Like if there's an opportunity that knocks, then go and stop second guessing. I was teaching people in my coaching group again about the 5 second rule. And this is something I can't think of if it's Beth Moore or who it is that's online. If you go Google search or YouTube 5 second rule, there's a book that's been written on it and she's amazing and she talks about this. But I use this now for video creation, especially with newbies who are not quite confident. The goal is basically that within five, once you start, you tell yourself you're going to do something, start the countdown. Because between 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, you're going to either negative self-talk yourself out of doing that thing, or you need to start putting yourself into action and having momentum. So her thought was, you start. As soon as you start thinking those negative self-talk things, because you are prepared to take an action, just move in a direction, even if you physically just get up and start walking. Move in the direction of your phone and start recording. Because you knew you were supposed to get this done 3 days ago, and you keep talking yourself out of why today is not the day. I'm not ready. My hair's not done, or my camera, my lighting's not right. Oh, I don't like my environment. I want to buy some. So we start throwing money out there instead of taking the action. And so that has been huge. I really embrace this 5 second rule. Now that I'm moving into this whole new phase, I'm like, yeah, do it.
That is, I'm reading Who Not How right now. And I don't know who, I can't think of the author right now, but the book is called Who Not How. And there's a chapter where they talk about procrastination. Worst chapter I could have ever read. Now it's an amazing book, right? And I love it, but it's the worst chapter that I could ever read right now for me, because the argument is procrastination is just acknowledging that your genius should be spent doing something else. So yes, this task is necessary, but it's not what you're best at. You should be doing something else. So how do we outsource this particular task? Which leads into who, not how, right? So not necessarily how should I do, more videos, but who can help me do more videos, right? So it's awesome, but you know me, now I'm looking at it as, maybe I'm not procrastinating. Maybe I'm a genius and I didn't know it. So
But now you're procrastinating on finding the who.
Exactly. So it's so now I'm going to adopt the 5 second rule with you, because I think that that's better for me. You know what I mean? Like either I'm going to start, or I'm just, it's going to be some coffee and a book or something like that. That is absolutely hilarious. Do you still live by ask, assign, and automate?
Oh yeah.
Talk to the
And how do
people.
you even remember this? Wow,
Man,
that's like way
listen.
back.
Listen, because that's so you start you were the first person to teach me that principle in terms of ask, assign, automate. And I didn't initially use it in business, but what I did use it in was parenting, right? And so
That's good.
I used it in parenting and being a husband. And now I've started, within the last maybe 3 or 4 years, started using it in business, but it never left me, because I think that it perfectly defines the three decisions that a leader has to make. So talk to the people about ask, assign, and automate.
And it's for me, it's actually act, assign, or automate.
Okay,
And
upgrade.
ask, you can definitely ask the question, should I be doing this? Or is this really even relevant at all to the goal that I set for myself? When I think of it now, in terms of act, assign, or automate, I'm thinking whatever it may be, it meaning, maybe it is a process that you're doing in your business. Maybe it's something that you're doing at home. Maybe it's, the kids. Maybe it's the pets. Maybe it's your coworkers. It could be whatever the situation or scenario is. If it's been put in your lap, you have those three decisions to make. Am I going to act on this? Am I going to go ahead and right now do the 5 second rule and apply action and do something with it? Or do I need to assign this? to someone else? Do I need to delegate? Do I need to outsource? Is it really something I even enjoy doing? Because I'm not a big fan of writing out email campaigns, or even honestly, these days, doing all my social media. Yes, I like to be engaged with my audience and with the people that are following, but I
Yes.
actually recently brought someone in, a new team member who is now mapping out strategy and social media posts for me so
Nice.
that I can spend more time serving, coaching, speaking, those things. So ACT, I'm going to be speaking and serving and coaching. I'm assigning things that I really don't want to do or don't really think are going to be income generating activities for me, signing
Yes.
that to her. And then automation has always been my thing. That's like my jam. Automation is, can you do a lifetime deal on a app or a piece of software that can do things for you while you are
Yes.
doing something else? That's what I love. I love finding tools that are going to help me to streamline all day.
Listen, I am a fan of automation, especially on those days. You talk about social media, especially on the days where I don't feel like posting, I don't feel like creating nothing. I just, and you know me, Twitter is my favorite social media platform of all time, right? Because it's the most honest of social medias to me. But there's days where I just don't have it, right? And I don't, I'm so grateful for tools like Buffer. And I think when we started, there was like Hootsuite. Now you got Calendly and Later app and all those stuff. I am so such a fan of automation that I think it should be required teaching, required learning. So
I do
totally agree
too.
with you there. What's your favorite for automation for videos?
Oh gosh. Right now, so I'm torn. This is a great question. Like my eyes probably lit up because I'm like,
They
ah.
did.
So videos, I am a huge fan, like I mentioned earlier, of repurposing into smaller clips, but I didn't want to spend 100 hours sitting
Finding
down editing.
the
I don't want to do that.
Right.
So there's two different apps that I actually love right now, and they're kind of in competition for me.
Okay.
One is Repurpose. It's called repurpose.io, I think.
Okay.
Okay. Now, what this tool does is it will take your, you can do your live stream, whether it's
Yeah.
on YouTube or on Facebook. If you set this up properly, what it will do is it will pull your live stream in. It will then clip it according to the timing that you've set. So you said 30 seconds, or I need 60 second clips, or I need 10 minute clips, whatever it is that you set.
Yes.
It will automatically import that live stream. And then, depending on how you've set it up, it will clip it according to the timing. It can add an intro and an outro to it.
Okay.
And it can convert that automatically and instantly on a schedule to Twitter, to LinkedIn, to all these different places. Now, I typically don't use that feature yet because I'm like, I want a little more control about
Sure.
which clip is being sent, right? But
Yes.
even setting the clippings, what you can do is after you completed doing your Facebook Live or your YouTube Live, you go into the description, and you know how you add chapters now to YouTube?
Yes.
When you add the timing into your description for either one of those styles of video, it will pull and create clips starting at that point.
Wow.
So when you talk about automation, that's huge because it literally can take those and turn them into pieces of social media content for you, either in square or vertical format. So that's automatically stories. That's automatically sound bites because it can
Right.
also do convert your video into audio form. It does all of that. However, the second competing app I got for a really great deal, which is why I'm like,
I
this great deal. It was a one time.
love it.
And it's well branded. Whereas Repurpose, they're working on some beta versions of branding and they're actually going to be connecting. I think they're integrating to Canva very soon in the very
Okay.
near future, which is awesome.
Yes, very
That's
much
really going to
so.
make it like,
Yeah.
that's going to be make it a no-brainer right there. But Content Fries, it's a little guy from, I can't remember what country, if it's the Ukraine or where he's from, But he's so sweet and such a smart kid. And he does not know how much he is. I think people are starting to give him a clue that he's doing an excellent job with this thing. But it
Okay.
does something similar. It doesn't do the auto posting to the different, places.
Sure.
But you can pull in any type of video. You can pull in any pre-recorded videos. You can, if you did your live stream, you can pull that in. You can pull. And what it does is it will break them down into these different pieces. The difference with Content Fries is that it has a whole library of different fonts. It has, you can add different images, your own images and emojis and all kinds of stuff to your clips. So it turns out to
Interesting.
be, yeah. I can send you some
Interesting.
examples when we get out.
Yeah, you know,
Send you
now
some.
I'm see now I'm learning stuff too. I'm excited. Keep going. I ain't gonna stop you, but I'm
Well, yeah.
excited
Dude, this is like, so to me, I just love the creative energy that
now. Right.
goes into these people that are creating these types of apps so that I can take my content that I did one time and now multiply that and have that scheduled out into Instagram or other posts. So I'm
Yeah.
not having to sit there and do it, right?
Right.
So automation all day.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah.
Act, assign, and automate. We talked about earlier finding the actual platform that your customers are going to be on. The question that I have for you, similar to that, is what does the process of finding your tribe look like? And the reason that I ask is because we always hear build it and they will come, keep going live, your tribe will find you. But what does the process look like while you're building and creating content, not necessarily knowing which platform is gonna break for you?
Another really interesting question. You said you're gonna have a lot of questions for me.
Listen, you know, coming on here, we got to talk, man. We got to catch up, talk, and interview at the same time.
And none of these are pre-prepared answers, by the way, for those of you who are listening and watching.
Right. I feel bad for some of my guests. I never give the questions out. But you know why, really quickly, I never give the questions out because I feel like if you're on this show, you are truly a subject matter expert. Right. And I respect everybody's hustle enough to not try to trip them up or catch them up. Right. We're having a real interview based off of integrity where we can talk about expertise and what we're learning and what that trajectory looks like. So I never give the questions out. I never do. And
I
I knew for
prefer
you, I
it.
wasn't going to have to anyway.
Yeah, I prefer that. Like, I want to speak from the heart. I
Right.
want to give whatever I can give from my own experiences. It doesn't have to be prepared for me.
Yeah.
But it's always funny because you get my wheels turning.
Yeah.
So, to your question, what does that look like? So, I will say this. Let me, I didn't share this earlier for those who don't know who I am or anything about me. I'm a big introvert. Like, I'm
Yes.
an introvert who has just learned to live in an extrovert world, right? And I say that because when I was trying to figure out who is my circle, who is my community, who can I
Yes.
influence, and who do I want to be around, I really wasn't clear at first. And I think most people aren't. And
Correct.
that's why you'll hear people say, well, I just want to work with women. Like I talked to somebody today who said that. That was her answer when I said, well, do you have something that you want to offer or monetize online?
Yeah.
And who is your audience? And she said, well, I want to work with women. And I was like, dang, that's too broad.
Yes.
Because what happened is I was out there chasing people, I was trying to find the people.
Right.
When I figured out who my people were and who I ideally most wanted to work with, then I could plant a flag and say, hey, I'm over here, instead of me constantly running and trying to look for them. So here's what the process looked like for me, and everybody's journey may be different. For
Yes.
me, it was a matter of really just kind of narrowing down a couple of lists.
I love lists. Keep going.
Oh, so you and I, because we think alike, that's why. So lists. So I had to work with people first. I had to put myself out there really to everybody, right? I had to do that first. And then as I started working with more people, I started making a list of this is something I don't want. I
Mm.
never want to work with a person who has these characteristics. I love working with people that are over here.
Yes,
Right? So
yes.
I have my list going of these are things I'll put up with. These are things I won't put up
Right.
with. And it started to become more and more clear the more I put myself out there and worked with different people. The other thing was I had to think about the topic or topics that I wanted to become an expert in.
Okay.
And so for me, it started out broad. It was marketing and branding.
Yes.
That's a lot.
Yeah, it encompasses a lot. Absolutely.
It's a lot. So I couldn't be the expert of all things branding and marketing for everybody with skin. It just, that's not, your budget is limited unless you are like Amazon or, you know, you're someone who is a big ticket player who has an endless infinite. It's if unless your budget is unlimited, you have to be clear on where you're going to spend not only your energy, but your dollars to promote yourself.
Yes.
And at first I didn't get that. So I was everywhere. Every time somebody asked me to speak somewhere or do a podcast or do a such and such, I'd be like, sure, I'll be there.
Right.
Until I figured out what that list looked like. And then as I started narrowing down that list and getting more clarity around what I wanted to be known as the expert of, those things started to converge. It was a process for me. For some people, maybe they come out the womb knowing, but I did not know. I got clear. I moved from branding and marketing expert to, you know what? I want to work specifically in the social media space to, that's still broad.
Right.
What content marketing? So the content that goes on your social media to, wait a minute, I'm really falling in love with video.
Amazing.
And so then I got to this spot where it was like, you know what? This is where I'm starting to see people that are coming my way specifically because they want to know how to do video.
Right.
So I planted my flag. That's when the people started to come. I planted my flag and I built my expertise. And then people were like, okay, she's the go-to for this.
Right. No, that's so key. We had Amber, you know, Amber Aziza, we had her on the show not too long ago, and paraphrasing, she said, you can't consider yourself an expert until you can talk for 48 hours uninterrupted. And I'm like, that's a lot of talking, but from your level of greatness, you built this funnel of expectations for yourself and who you wanted to work with and what your ideal client looked like. So my question now is, what does expertise look like for Tanya Smith?
For me or for my clients?
For you, then for your clients.
Okay, so for me, it looks like I am being fully and completely who I say I am. Mm. And that I am giving everything that I have without adding the extra. Meaning that I think a lot of times what people will do when they're trying to become an expert is they'll say that I'm the king of all things or the queen of all things.
Right.
I don't even want to pretend to be that.
Yeah.
So when people come to me, and they ask for advice, if they want a, you know, videographer, I'm really clear on saying, yeah, I probably could do that, but that's not really my space. That's outside of my scope.
Right.
But here's what I can do. I can help to provide you with coaching and consulting and strategy so that you can use your videos, not just to get out there and get some likes, but to also actually generate client conversion.
Yeah.
So I got clear on the four components, the four buckets, my lanes that I run in. My four buckets are confidence building, content creation, consistency systems, and conversion to clients. And then I said, I'm committed to learning everything I can about how to do that with video in all four of those buckets. Mm-hmm. And if it falls outside of the scope of those things, I don't promise that. So I think being an expert for me was about getting crystal clear on the lanes that I run in and making sure that I do all that I can to learn, and not just to learn once, because the challenge these days is that everything moves at such a fast pace. So
Yes.
that means I still have to have a coach, just like I'm coaching other people.
Let's go. Let's
Okay.
go.
I got to stay on top of trends. I got to have news feeds coming to me telling me what the new, the latest and greatest thing is. Like, I know social audio
Right.
is booming right now, and I am connected to different pieces and to people that have resources in those spaces so I can learn and understand what is the difference. Because at some point, somebody's going to come and ask me, why should I do video if I can do Clubhouse?
Right. Right. Because nobody like talking on the phone that long. But that's another
Right.
subject. I just, that's another
I know.
thing. That's another
That's a
thing.
whole show.
Right. Like, I totally understand the relevance and the necessity for a clubhouse. History repeats itself. And party lines have been around since the beginning of the phone. It's one thing to be considered an expert. It's another to have a platform. It's a whole different one to just position yourself as one and then mute somebody else's mic. There's a level of arrogance there that
Yeah.
I can't do. And I've been on some clubhouses, right? I've done some talking, some moderating, and it don't feel right for me.
Think, and I won't go too far down that rabbit hole because this will be the rest of your show if we do, but I will say
Right.
this. I'm gonna say this because Clubhouse Green Room is the new one, Spotify Green Room.
Yes,
And
I
then
got that
Facebook has come
notification.
out. Facebook podcast has come out this week, actually, maybe today or a couple of days ago. So there's a lot going on. Here's what I do appreciate about those things. Like you
Yes.
said, what's old is new, right?
Yeah.
What I appreciate is that because we play in a media space, in a content marketing space, we can clearly see and identify the things that will work for us probably more quickly than some who are not quite in that space. And here's a couple of tips that I do think would be important for anybody who's thinking about exploring social audio. One is don't hitch your wagon to people who are you are not equally yoked with.
Let's go.
Because there are a lot of folks, as you just said, Chuck, who they're saying one thing, and it's easy to talk a good game on the phone or on audio, and
Yeah.
nobody can see the rest, what's really going on.
Right.
So that's one thing. Connect in rooms that actually are relevant for you, both personally and professionally, because there are spaces where I found some golden nuggets, and
Yes.
I've made some, built some really strong connections and networks with people because we're not in that age of us being able to go out. And frankly, I didn't go out and do all those networking business things anyway.
Right.
So this has been a comfortable way for me to do that from a virtual standpoint.
Yeah.
And the second thing is to be real clear about where that social audio fits into your overall marketing strategy because it may not
Right.
fit. Don't try to
Yeah.
force feed it to your audience and to your system.
I think one of the things that people get caught up in, and again, we've been playing in this space for quite some time, but I think people get caught up in giving away so much content in those spaces that now they don't have an offering anymore, right? It's because they've told everything just by trying to gain the following. They've told everything that they would have typically had as a class or a coaching program or anything like that. They've given it away. And now they have to come up with something new. And so you spent all this time trying to get Clubhouse or Green Room or whatever it is up and running that now the people that were going to follow you and purchase from you on a different platform are now like, oh, I got it. Never mind. Don't need it. And
I
they,
haven't had that experience.
well, because you're a guru. You know these things. But I
That's so
tell you,
funny when you say
you come
that.
on, but you are like I've had entrepreneurs come to me and say, Chuck, I had someone tell me, that they were getting ready to purchase my program or my class or whatever the case is, but they ended up not needing to because they listened to me on Clubhouse and I gave away so much that I met them where they
Yeah,
were already.
I
And
can
I've
see that.
heard that over and over again. And I'm just like, sometimes you got no when to stop talking. You just
Those
and
out those rooms can run for hours long. So you're right. So commit, cut yourself off. I'm only going to be on for an hour.
Right.
I'm only going to be on for 30 minutes and I'm on for this purpose. And here's
Yes.
what I think though. I think that the people who are meant to be your clients will show up and they will come and they will get additional support and more from you. I think that for those who are just there because, hey, I just wanted to come in here and get, I'm a squirrel trying to get a nut. I'm trying to get,
Yes.
information so I can move on and take it and go do something else with it. Those people have always been there. They
Yeah.
didn't start coming to Clubhouse, they've been there. Those people were eating up your lead magnets and your opt-in forms and taking that stuff and then running with it without ever coming back to buy a program. So I think you're right that that can be a challenge, especially for somebody who's new, is to knowing when to cut it off. But if they're listening now and they want a tip on that and they still want to, be in those spaces, the tip would be you talk about the what and why, but save your how for the paid program.
Yes.
Your how, your process, your system, that's what people pay for. That's what people pay the big bucks for. So you talk about the what, here's what it is you need, and this is why you need it.
Yes.
And if you want to know how, hit me up in the DMs.
I love it. I love it. So strategic, so intentional. So social proof, we're getting close to wrapping up, but social proof is something that is mandatory these days. And you have so many amazingly positive customer reviews. Have you gotten used to it? How does it feel when those come across your desk and they say, you know, Tanya has changed my life and now I'm making more money because of her offerings and what she taught me?
I love it, but I don't love it for the reason that some might love it.
Okay.
Some might love it because, hey, this makes me look good, right?
Yeah.
Because social proof does make you look good.
Absolutely.
It's what people are looking to see. What is so and so saying? We're
Yep.
all looking for referrals, right? We look for, I look for re references when I go buy a product on Amazon. I'm looking at the ratings in the comments. So people are going to do that for you too. But I love it because to me, it's showing there's different phases that I've gone through and grown through as an entrepreneur, and you too, you get this.
Yeah.
There are different phases and I feel the growth inside, but they're like an outward reflection of that growth. That's my proof that what I said I was gonna do, I'm doing it. It's being done. What I promised I could give and could deliver is showing up. Like, and I love seeing the light bulbs and I love seeing people win because
Yeah.
of the work that we've done together. That's what lights me up. It makes me feel like it's all been worth it. All the nights and the weekend. Because I still do juggle. I juggle
Listen.
a corporate job on top of my business.
Right.
I juggle my husband being in out of country for months. We have not seen him. It's going to be a year in August.
Oh, man.
I
Oh,
juggle a freshman in college now going to our sophomore year. But so I do all these things. And some days, some nights at 2 o'clock in the morning when I wake up and I think, oh, I needed to get this done. Some
yeah.
nights I think, is it worth it?
Right.
So for me, those testimonials are a reminder that you're here to serve and your purpose is being fulfilled.
Yeah.
That's what you're doing.
People that are watching this on YouTube probably see me flailing around. It's because I get so excited. It literally just clicked that you were while you were talking, something that we go through a lot, and that's wondering if the personal growth is worth it. Like right before you said it, I was like, the personal growth is now reflecting in the candidate, in the customer success, right? And they, because you did that work, they can now experience this success. That is literally what was popping through my mind. And so I, yeah, if you guys saw me flailing around, that's why it was, because it literally just kicked in that was
Yeah.
what it was. It's just, and it's so, I want to say personally, it's refreshing because there's no rewards for personal growth outside of, typically for entrepreneurs, there's no rewards. There's no attaboys. There's no trophies. Yes, there's checkbooks. Yes, there's bank accounts, but there's no tangible emotional attachment to personal growth outside of somebody else saying, you know what, you helped me. And that I think will never get old. It'll never be out of style. And even when we talked years ago, when you were on my very first podcast, I asked you what kept you moving, what kept you going. I don't know if you remember this. And everybody to that point had given a version of the answer is half money and half, you know, I have goals and dreams, right? They all gave me the politically correct answer before we knew what politically correct was. But you were the only person to say, the only thing, one of the things, the main thing that keeps me going is other people's success. And for you to still be saying that this long is a testament to your greatness. Don't cry. Don't cry.
No, I don't have tissues over here right now. Don't do that to me.
But it is. I think I sent you the old interview that we had, but I listened to that as we were, you know, getting closer to the date. And I just remember so specifically that there were things that drive you that are different from everybody else. And maybe it's because you juggle all of the things that you do, but the personal growth that you put in, the time that you put in has never been in vain. Like, you've always managed to help people specifically for the thing that they've come to you for. And I think that's amazing.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. So let's lighten it up a little bit, right?
Yeah.
burnout is absolutely real. What does Tanya do when she has one of those days or weeks when she's like, I'm over it. I don't want to see no camera lens. I don't want to see no phone. I'm going to flip all this stuff over. Like, what does Tanya do then?
I have definitely had some flip the table moments. That's for real. That's for real, for real. I think for me, I am so structured and so disciplined at this point. For instance, because I've committed to doing the weekly live stream every Thursday.
Yes.
I know that if I don't show up, there will be people wondering why. right?
Checking to see if you're okay.
Yeah, is she okay? And so I actually did have to take a day off not that long ago, a day of my live stream off, because I was so exhausted. There were so many things that I was trying to take care of, so many issues that I needed to solve.
Yes.
And so when I feel like that now, I have realized that I am okay with giving myself the grace and the permission. The key to me, when I give myself the grace and the permission to just take a pause and say, okay, everything stops. Everything. Like, I'm turning off the phone, TV's going off. I'm going to just sit in a bath and listen to an Audible book. Like, yeah. I just want to do that. I have now started building in those moments into my calendar, right?
Yes.
But there's still going to be times where you just feel so overwhelmed. And so I gave myself the grace to, and the permission to say, I'm taking this time off. But what I had to make sure I do, because once you are an entrepreneur, part of your time is owed to people who follow you.
Yes.
So I made a point of communicating. And that's the thing where I see people fall the most, when they burn out and then they just stop altogether saying anything and they just don't communicate and they just ghost their whole audience. That's when it becomes problematic for you, because you've just chipped away at the trust that you took so long to build. So when I get to that place, which definitely does happen more often than not over the past year or so, I take a break. I decided I was going to take the kids. We're going to go on a trip in a few weeks. We're going to go on a trip. And so I'm planning ahead about what I'm going to say and what I'm going to communicate to people and who needs to know. You know, but not to the point to where I'm creating a security issue, especially for you women out there. We can't put all our stuff out there on social media street.
Yes.
Like, we got to be careful, really anybody. You got to be careful. You're not telling people how long you're going to be gone and where you're going, and your house is now open for burglars and all that. You don't want to do that. But I'm just saying, find a way to communicate to people that I'm going to be offline for a little bit.
Right.
Right. And do whatever it takes to, because your mental sanity and refresh is paramount. If you're not full, and if you feel like you're ready to just fall out, it's going to show up, especially on camera.
Oh,
It's going to
man.
be, it's all on video. Like people can see all that in your face and your facial
Yes.
expressions. So I'm really big on the energy level and making sure that I watch that and being okay with saying, I can't do this tonight.
One of the things that I wish I would have learned earlier is that as a dream chaser, I won't even say entrepreneur, as a dream chaser, period. Those times where you don't protect your mental space because you're trying to take on so much, you never get back to 100%, right? So we have to learn how to identify it early so that we only drop to 98, because you can only get back to 97. You know what I mean? Like you can never get back to 100%. And so I think that it's hugely important that you just mentioned that. Not too long ago, I had a week from Jesus Christ. It had to be the week created from hell, but I did it to myself. I was moderating a conference, right? Moderating interviews or facilitating interviews for a conference. I had a personal goal that I had a deadline for in terms of licenses and stuff like that. And then I had three things to do for the podcast, all in the same week. And when I tell you, thank God for automation, because the week after I slept for like 72 hours. It was sleep, whiskey, sleep, a couple of TV shows with the wife. Like I
Coffee.
didn't, yeah. No, I didn't. I didn't want to stay awake. Like no coffee, which created migraines, of course, because I'm addicted to coffee. Like it was a mess. It was a total mess.
Oh, wow.
And so not too long after that, my wife comes and she's like, you know what? What do you have on your calendar tomorrow? And I was like, not much. Why? What do you need? She was like, nothing. Just don't do nothing. Just take the day, don't do anything. And I was like, oh, what do you like? Me not do anything?
I
Me?
know I can
Like,
do
right? It was just crazy. And then so I turned around and had her do the same thing. And I think it's important that we protect that space, because you never get back to 100%. So I think it's awesome that you mentioned that. Of course, obviously with the security thing as well. Did COVID make it harder for you to be an entrepreneur, or did it open the floodgates because we saw all these new people launching businesses?
It really gave me another opportunity. And honestly, I look at anything that everybody else is saying, oh my God, this is horrible. I look at that and try to look for what is the message for me here? Like, what can I learn from this situation versus, oh, it's happening to me. And so, because I easily could have fell into that trap, especially with
Yes.
Preston being gone, and all the things were happening, all the things. So I think that because of the situation, people were trying to learn how to do more video, how to be more comfortable doing all these Zoom
Yes.
calls. Like,
Oh,
what kind of
man.
stuff should I invest in to have at my desk so I can be ready and set up to go? And how do I
Right.
blur out my background? And how do I use Google Meet versus this? So I had a lot of different questions. I had a major player in the I'm gonna call her Mini Oprah.
Okay.
And I won't say her name, but she had a need to immediately move a 3-day offline. It was a conference that people had paid tens of thousands of dollars to attend
Wow.
in person, I think in Atlanta.
Okay.
But it couldn't take place because everything
Right.
shut down. So I worked with her team over the span of like 3 weeks to move them completely to a virtual space.
Wow.
Like, here's how we're gonna run this Zoom conference for 3 days. Here's the agenda. And I sat down with her team and mapped it out. I used a program called Session Lab because I'm a software geek, right? Mapped all
Yes.
the whole 3 days out, talked about like here's etiquette that you're not going to be used to because it's virtual now versus on offline. Here's
Yeah.
some other things your team needs to think about that they're going to need to kind of change their minds about, the
Those
exercises
icebreakers are
y'all used
different
to do,
now.
all of that, all
Yes.
icebreakers, breakout rooms, all of that. So that opened up opportunities for me, to be honest, Chuck. But there were people that were calling, and I was like, I can't, I don't want to do that. Like,
I love
I
it.
could do it, but I don't want. And because I have that clarity and that I know who I am, I know what I do, I know who I want to work with, it was easier for me to say no in spite of the money.
Yes.
Because I know
Yes.
if I had taken on some of those projects that people were coming to me for, I would have hated life.
I
I
love
would
that
have
you have
hated.
clearly defined non-negotiables. Like, that is one of the hardest things for entrepreneurs to ever even get to that part of business, is knowing when to say no to opportunities.
Yeah. I
Because we
mean,
want all the
even
money.
now, we want the money. We want the money. I used to take every discovery call. You know how coaches do discovery calls? I used to do
Yes.
anybody who wanted to set up something on my calendar, it was open season. And I'd
Yeah.
show up and I'd be like, well, who is this person? I don't even know what, like, what are we talking about?
What
And
they
we get
do.
on the line and they'd be like, I just wanted some advice. Can you just give me some advice? Well, no, that's not how this works. So even that I have gotten clear on over the past couple of years by investing in my own coach to
Yep.
use my non-negotiables to create a system that works for me. So it's an application process.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I got a free community. Join the free community to get some
Some
tips
free
on the fly.
advice.
Right. But if
Oh,
you
man.
want to be a part of an actual coaching program or my academy, then we need to go through the process. I need to know who you are, what you're about, because I want to know that you're right for me, just like you want to know that I'm right for you. All money is not good money.
Perfect lead into the next question, as we get close to wrapping up. How do
Okay.
people know if they're ready for consistent live video work with the great one, Tanya Smith? What's the process that they go through to know if they're good enough to work with you, or if they're ready to work with you, I should say?
Yeah, not good enough because I think everybody wants
Listen,
to look.
I'm setting up barriers for you. Like, you ain't good enough. You ain't good
You
enough.
are, you are. And you know, I just need you to be my hype man. Like, just be there, like, hey.
Or be your too big MC for Hammer, like, I'm just...
I think the best way for people to figure out whether or not they're video ready is first of all to think about it. Like, am I really thinking about video or am I just saying, hey, I don't know. Because I've had people that have, for instance, joined the community, joined the group, and then they've
Yes.
written me a couple weeks later and said, you know what? I realize now I don't really want to do it. Would you feel bad if I disconnect? And I'm like, no, please. No, this is a
Self-select.
space for people who, and I'm clear in the wording, this is a space for people who want to learn and grow their business using video strategy. If
Yes.
that's not your cup of tea, that's okay. I'm not offended by that. So, video readiness, I have a quiz that I've created and it's at quiz.getnoticedwithvideo.com. That's the best place to start in my world, to understand where you are. And when you take the quiz, you get sent directly based on your answers to a guided video that's going to tell you a little bit about what your results told you. And
Oh,
then it's
wow.
going to give you access to a guide that you can actually print off. You can review it. You can get the tips out of it. You can go on about your business if you're like, no, I'm not ready. Right? Because I had a lady do that. And again, she was like, I'm just not ready for this, for the coaching
Yeah.
program. But I am ready to jump into the community and put my toe in the water. And I said, that's the best place for you to start.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, quiz, being a part of the community and the group and listening and watching the live streams every week so that you know, is she somebody I can kick it with?
I think managing expectations is one of the greatest things we can do
Yeah.
as humans, just to make sure that we are in the right spot. So I love the process. I love how, instinctual it is, how intentional, we keep coming back to that word, how intentional it is. Absolutely honored to have had you on. I got to do my two questions, my rapid fire.
Okay.
So I'm gonna give you two words. You tell me what they mean to you, and then we wrap up. The first word is visionary.
Wow. Visionary means that you are someone who has a huge dream. And maybe it's not even a huge dream, but you have a clarity about what you want to work towards. And you can communicate that in everything that you say. but also in your actions. And the people around you feel it and they want to be a part of it. When you have a vision, the people around you that are intended to be attracted to that vision to help you get to where you need to go will be there.
Always love your answers. Always love your answers. Second word is grace.
Grace. That this is one of my favorite words. This has become one of my favorite words. Grace means giving yourself permission. It means allowing. It means being open. It means it's a sacred word. It's about being open to things that were meant for you. Even if they feel bad or feel good, whatever they feel like, but being open to whatever the message is, and then being willing to take the action on that feeling.
I love so, it.
Permission.
Very strong. Where can everybody find Coach Tanya online?
The best place is getnoticedwithvideo.com. That's my website. That's my home online, getnoticedwithvideo.com. And then I broadcast right now to all the channels, although I'm thinking about streamlining that in order to combine my audience and not have my audience so split into different places. So I'm really strategically kind of repositioning in the next month or so.
Okay.
But tanya.video/links will take people to where I'm broadcasting, like where I'm doing my weekly live stream. So either one of those two links.
You always have the new stuff, right? Like when we first talked, I remember you were the first person to tell me about .me pages, like way back in the day. And now it's tanya.video.link. Like you always got the new stuff. This is, it ain't fair. It's not fair at all.
If you know, I hook you up. If you need any type of tips.
Oh, you know, always.
Short links are the bomb. Short links mean everything.
Oh, man. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, you have been rocking with the great one, Tanya Smith, and yours truly, Chuck Hawkins, here at the Hawk Vision Podcast, teaching you how to get noticed with video. I hope this interview was informative, that we added a smile to your day, but most importantly, we hope we helped you shorten the learning curve on your journey to success. We've heard you. We got your questions. Patreon support coming soon. A lot of it exciting, exclusive content coming there. So if you want to support the show, have that one-on-one, have your questions answered, so much more. We got a lot coming there. Like, share, and subscribe across all of your social media platforms. Send in your messages, your guest suggestions. If they match, hopefully we can make it work. I cannot continue to grow this show without you guys, my visionaries. And I am so appreciative that you've given us some time for your day. You know how it goes. There's absolutely no miracle that will ever happen without somebody doing something. We will either see you at the top or from the top. Thanks for coming out, guys. Tanya, thank you again. You killed it.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. It's always so much fun to talk to you.
Thanks.